powered by NVIDIA Quadro.
Classic Car or Muscle Car, we want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
Right now on Autorestomod, Larry hammers and grinds and hammers and grinds. Larry. Jeff passes out compliments and we see the antenna hole filled.
Order a bunch of parts to get ready for the car show this weekend.
And I got a hot deal.
You think? Think again.
Oh man.
Tired of back orders? You need NPD. With four strategically located superstores, orders are shipped direct to your door within 1 to 3 business days. National Parts Depot has quality restoration parts for Ford truck, Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, and Firebird. For your free catalog, visit NPD online or call toll-free.
Previously on Autorestomod.
You know what we could do is we could get the panel bonding adhesive, we could go in there with the panel bonding adhesive and give it, we'd be out of here like.
We can't do that. We have some nice high spots and some low spots, and we're just going to try to make us a pattern.
Well, I'm going to get out of here if you're going to weld.
We ground us a spot on the bottom of the fender, and we're going to hook our ground clamp to it. We're going to take our magnet and see if we can get this thing to fit up. And then we're going to make our first tack. Now, once you get one side tacked, now is the time to make sure that if you need to make any adjustments to it and try to move it around or bend it, this is the time. Until we definitely get it stable, we're going to continue doing it the same way. We're going to let it cool, and we're going to look at it, feel it, okay? You see, it's looking pretty good, but we got to do a little bit of tweaking on it. You can get you a nice little pick and move it around as you need. We're going to hold this down just a touch as we weld it over here. We're gonna take our grinder, we're gonna cut this thing down just a little bit and see if we can move that a little more. It's sticking up just a touch. You know, in the old days, they would just knock this thing in and throw some fiberglass over it and Bondo over that, but it never did last a long time. If you can't touch it, it is too hot to weld on anymore. And it is okay to put some, run some air over it, try to cool it off if that's what you need. Best thing is just to be patient though.
Larry, that looks nice.
Thank you. Now we gotta come back and we got to weld up these four holes.
Now you basically went in and really worked that. I mean, it's not like this was just one of those snap your fingers things. You spent probably a good 20, 30 minutes.
Yeah.
Going in, spot welding,
yep.
Grinding, spot welding, grinding.
That's right.
Now, these holes are basically a lot like what you would see on the medallions on the sides of a lot of these 60s muscle cars, right?
That's
so basically now what you're gonna do is you're gonna show them how to fill these little holes here and then do the final fill and sand and all that
That's
to make
right.
it look decent.
That's right.
Well, that part looked decent. We got larger issues.
Decent spot.
One good spot.
One good spot on the car. We're just going to take the welder
and
we're just going to catch it right on the side and we're just going to kind of backfill it.
Okay.
And you're not going to be able to do the entire hole in one shot.
You'll right.
You have to spot a weld, you know.
And all the way around.
You're kind of the same way that we did on this.
Okay.
Now, if you have a bigger hole and you have that's hard to get to, you can actually take a piece of copper and flatten it out.
Right.
Like a piece of copper tubing, flatten the end, and slide it in behind it, and you can weld on top of it, use that for your filler, and it won't stick to the copper.
And you still want to do the cool it, let it wait
you
and cool
still
it, otherwise you're going to have a lot of problems
That's
with it
right.
and warp.
That's right.
I'll let you get to it, man. It looks like you're doing
do
a great
it.
Job on it.
Okay, like I said, all we're going to do is come into the side of this thing, and I'll show you what we're doing here. One little plug, we'll come over here. Like I said, just like what we did on the rest. You don't just sit there and gun that thing and warp it all up. Make sure we're not getting too much heat. After we get these four welded, we'll finish grind it, and then we're gonna sand out around here, and we'll start with our getting ready for our body filler. Hopefully, all it's gonna take is one nice little skim coat of filler if we've done our hammer work good enough. While this thing is still hot, if you see an area that has kind of took a little too much heat and it's kind of puckered up, take your hammer and try to just bump it down a little bit. You know, when we're restoring these cars, nothing on this is fast anyway, so you might as well just take the time, make sure you get it right the first time. The fender's actually, the contour's still feeling good. It hadn't changed it much. Heat's not traveling far. It feels like a little hump right there. We're gonna go ahead while that thing's warm and bump that down just a touch. We got just a little hole there and just a little one here, and we'll be about done with this thing. We're getting out the grinder. We're gonna use a belt grinder to start with, just to knock the top off. You're not gonna do the entire grind job with it. You don't have to use one of these. You can use your standard 3-inch. Just make sure that you don't grind the rest of the fender. You're just trying to stay on top of that weld. A little bit of a hump in it. We're just gonna bump that down and we'll be ready for some filler. This fender actually has a little roll in it right here, and that's why this keeps kind of swelling here. All right, let's get it ready for some filler.
All right, we're in the final stage of this. So Larry, what's next?
It's time to 80 grit around here, give us our feather edge on our paint. We're gonna put a little
you could feather edge that.
Well,
it looks like an alligator skin.
It's pretty close. We're gonna go back later and
do
finish
all
out
that.
The,
yeah,
do
yeah.
All
I mean, that's
this. So right now we just focus on that one.
Yeah, because I don't want that to rust out.
Yeah.
I mean, I'll let you get on it, man.
Okay, we're gonna start off with some 80 grit on a DA 6-inch. That's the most common. It's gonna be 6-inch anymore. Rarely do you see 5. All right, we're ready for some filler, and I'm gonna talk about filler for just a moment while I'm mixing this up. There's a lot of different types of filler out there. Don't just run to your local paint supplier and buy just the cheapest thing that they have. It's gonna make you work harder, and it's not gonna do as good of a job. You want a good premium filler. I work for Finishmaster, and we carry Smart Products, and they have a premium line that's economical, works great. A lot of your good top-end fillers have corrosion protection and all built in, but when you deal with those cheaper fillers, a lot of the lightweight stuff and all is like trying to spread stucco. It doesn't spread real smooth. Not only does it not spread smooth, it doesn't sand smooth. The correct amount of hardener, if you noticed, I just put one little strip across there. The correct amount is considered to be 2% by volume. Whenever they sell you a gallon of filler and you got one tube of hardener, it only takes that one tube. Does not need a whole pile of it. And when you talk about the 2% of hardener, don't change the amount of hardener based on the temperature, because that is a habit that a lot of people get into. Is in the summertime, they'll try to leave some out, and in the wintertime, they'll try to add more. It needs 2% for it to be correct. The companies build this products for that amount for a reason. You notice this spreads out really smooth. It should be kind of like cake batter. Your first wipe across should be fairly tight, trying to keep as many of the air bubbles and stuff out of it. And then you can lighten it up as you go. That's pretty much all we needed there. We'll give that time to dry, and then we'll take a block with some 80 grit and cut that down. All right, you see we've gave our filler a little time to dry. It's got just a hair bit of tackiness to it, but you're gonna notice it'll actually scratch. That's about the best time to sand it. You don't want to walk away from this and just leave it overnight. The longer it sets, the harder it's gonna get, so it's gonna be a little tougher to sand. We're gonna go over this with 80, and if it looks good, we're not gonna try to totally flatten it with 80, because we want to have room to go back with 180 to remove the 80 grit scratch. It's all a series of going from a rougher paper to a smoother paper so that you can gradually get that scratch down. All right, if you notice, it's standing out real well. It's doing everything we wanted it to do. So the trick here at this point is not to sand too much of it off. It's knowing when to leave it alone. All right. We're gonna swap over to some 180. And make another pass. All right, looks good, feels pretty good, but for the guys that hadn't quite developed that feel yet, take you some dry guide coat, which is basically like a black graphite. You can rub that on there, and then you can come over here, hit it back with your block, and this will highlight anything that you got going on as far as any highs or lows. All right, looks pretty good. Now, if you notice the way that I was rolling this block, I wasn't doing all of it just straight back and forth. The reason I was doing it this way was because of the roll that this fender has, is you're having to try to use this edge to make this roll and make sure that it stays even. So you're kind of taking your hand and rolling it in there, okay? Now we're gonna take some, basically some 320 sandpaper, sand right around the edge of here for our primer to have something to lay into, and we'll be ready for some primer. Okay, now you see that we've got this finished off at our 180. We're gonna take our 320 on a DA, feather it out a little more. We want to have a good edge for that, a good bite for that primer to lay up into. Now keep in mind, the reason for finishing this off as good as we did is that we only want about 3 coats of primer. 3 coats of good urethane primer should take care of any bodywork application unless you're just trying to build a whole part, right? See our paint, our sanded edge around here. We're looking good. So now we're gonna pull all of this off and then we're gonna remask this thing in a way to be able to do our primer. All right, guys, we got this thing wrapped up, getting ready to put some primer on it. I wanted to point out a couple of things real quick. If you notice all along the areas here, we wanna make sure we didn't get primer overspray on anything that would possibly get hurt, not that we could hurt this paint. You just don't want to get it in anywhere that it doesn't need to be, okay? You'll notice that I took some 1.5-inch tape, or you can use some 2-inch, and kind of just roll that back. Run a piece and roll it back and then tape it. You don't want to have a hard tape line. You want to be able to have a soft edge, because if you chop this off here and you created that little box to keep your primer in, all it's gonna do is give you a lump there that you'll never get rid of. Even up against the fender, I opened the hood, I took the tape, rolled it on the inside, shut it, and rolled it back. That gives a nice edge for the painting all over here, but it also makes sure that that jam is totally sealed up so nothing is gonna get in there, and also nothing's gonna blow back out of it. You notice we have some bare metal areas showing around here. Most of our good urethane primers, that is really considered somewhat acceptable. They tell you nothing no bigger than a quarter that you can put over bare metal. We got enough here. We're gonna at least just take some Sim self-etch primer. We're just gonna do one medium to light coat just on the bare metal areas. This is gonna give our metal a little bite. We won't have to worry about any corrosion issues and all with our primer later. All right, you're not trying to do this like you're painting it. All you're trying to do is get a medium coat, and with this, a medium coat, you can still see through. You'll see you can almost see through color-wise. That's all you want on there. You don't need to saturate it, and you don't need to put it over the body filler no more than what it oversprays onto. If you see it glossy anywhere, then it is not ready for primer. Okay, guys, you see our edge primer is flashed off. Now we have a good urethane two-component primer. You do not want to mess with any lacquer type primers or anything that doesn't have a catalyst. There again, don't go get the cheapest, but you don't have to go get the most expensive. The rules of spraying primer are the same no matter what brand of primer that you use. And that is, we're going to put one medium coat on here as far out as what we intend to go, period. And then we're going to let it flash off, and by flash off, that means nothing shiny. Then we're going to step it in, let that flash, and then we're going to go back with a single coat on top that only covers the repair. That actually layers up your product and it helps it blend in better. Don't need a bunch of air pressure, but at the same time, you need to make sure you have enough that you're not spraying it and it looking like rock guard. Okay, remember, you got to go back and try to sand this. All right, make sure that you wear your respirator. Make sure you have good clean air. Make sure you got good filters on your airline system. Think of that as an accelerator pedal. It does not have to be wide open all the time. Drive it like you was driving a car. Practice with it if you need to. Okay. That's all the first coat needs to be. It doesn't need to be anything more than that. We're going to walk away from this until it flashes off naturally. Do not sit here with air, with your gun or anything, blowing across it, trying to force it dry. Only thing that you're going to do is cause yourself some problems, because you're going to make it dry on the top side before it dries underneath. Okay, you're going to trap a lot of solvents in there, and it's going to dull out in your paint job later. You notice we got it flashed. We're going to come in with our second coat. We're going to put a pretty decent coat on there, but we're not coming all the way out here. So this is centering it inward. So this is going to have our last coat right where we need it the most. So our next coat is going to come a couple of inches in, about an inch in from where we're at now. See, nice and simple. Notice it's got a smooth texture to it. If you don't have it that smooth, you don't have the right setup in the gun or using the wrong air pressure, okay? Don't be afraid to put you some paper on the wall and adjust your pressure and check your fluid tip sizes and all that, and get it adjusted like you want it before you start on the vehicle. So here again, we'll let that flash off and we'll do our final coat, bringing it in a little further just over the body filler. All right, guys, we know that we already got it flashed. We're going to do the same thing as we did last time. We're just stepping in one more inch, okay? Like I said, that creates a better transition. Notice how fine the overspray is off on the edge. You don't want this thing, like I said, you don't want it looking like stucco. This should be a good enough repair that you should be able to either water sand this thing with some 500 or DA sand with some 400 and put it in the booth, with the exception of the rest of the work we still have to do. And we'll get to that later. And that's it.
Okay, so we're waiting on the primer to dry right now. I'm going to go over something real quick with you. You may be asking yourself, why didn't we go in and actually pull the fender off to prime it? And the reason for that is this. Quite frankly, with that repair, you can leave it bare like that in behind that water shield, and you're never going to have a real issue with it in the life of the car for as old as most of us are. We will probably die long before that repair rusts out. But if you're feeling kind of funky about it and you actually want to do something, what you should do is go in with either a product like POR15 or an epoxy primer. Because if you use an epoxy primer, it's not going to pull in any moisture. The primer that we're going to be using right here on the car, it should be top coated. Epoxy primers, they're going to hold up over the length of the car. And quite frankly, if I were going to do it, I would probably just go in and use a little POR15 on the underside of that fender, and everything should be good to go. Larry, This yes, sir? Looks awesome.
Well, thank you.
I wish the rest of the car looked like this. Say, you wouldn't interested in going ahead and just taking care of all this? I'll just leave it here for the next couple months or years.
No. Okay. I got enough junk to work on.
Yeah, I was looking at the rutabaga back there.
Hey.
That's a lot of work.
That's a lot of work.
I was going to tell you one thing, too. You know, you said the thing about throttling, right?
Yes, I did.
I'm going to tell you right now, I've seen Vince and Dustin drive.
Mm-hmm.
We should never let them have...
No throttle control.
None whatsoever. It's either off or it's on the floor. So.
Well, we definitely don't want to be loading it up, and we don't want it running off on the floor. So either you make a mess or you learn how to use the throttle.
Maybe there's something we could teach about.
There you go.
All right, folks, that's our show for this week. Next, we're going to be coming back to you with how to put a dash pad in a 1964 Le Mans. We're going to be working on Larry's car. Now, some guys have written in and asked us, where's Vince? Well, Vince has taken a job that is requiring him to do a lot more stuff on the weekends. He's not able to be with us as much now. So Larry's going to step in and help us with a few of our shows here and there, show us some really hot tips on doing body work. He's got a ton of experience in this industry. He knows all these little ins and outs. So that's what's coming up next week. Do us a favor, though, and come back and watch us next time on Autorestomod. Have a great week, folks.
Good to see y'all.